All right. We're so glad that you have joined us this morning. Wow. All I can say is wow, okay? And you're like, why are you saying wow, preacher? Well, listen, the last church service that I just had, the last hour was absolutely a God-led, God-spirit hour. I mean, like, his spirit is here right now. And I'm telling you that God did something in the last service that we all needed. And I'm telling you that you're coming into an environment right now that I'm telling you the spirit is thick in the room today. He's thick in the room, and he's here, and he wants to do something not just with those people that were here before. He wants to do something in your life as well. And I couldn't be more thrilled and honored to be here to talk to you about a brand new message series we're starting called Dangerous Prayers. And we're going to dive in here in just a couple minutes on this, but I just want to go ahead and set this up by saying this for a lot of people in the room. Over the next few weeks as we go over this message series, I believe that one of these messages is going to be what we call an anchor message. You say, Pastor, what's an anchor message? An anchor message is one of those messages that when you hear it and you're in the presence of God, that God just speaks in such a loud voice and so clearly to you that you go, when I heard that specific thing, it changed my entire life. Like, I literally believe one of the next few messages is going to be like that for many people in the room. And I watched it happen as people left in tears in the last service just because God was doing something. And I'm telling you, I'm not going to be able to stand up here with as much energy and passion as I have and be able to manufacture what I saw. I can't manufacture that. Man can't create that. It's whenever heaven collides with earth, when God collides with a human being, and all of a sudden he begins to work in a person's heart, that's the only way it happens. And I'm telling you, you should be expecting God to do something over the next 25 minutes. Of our time together, you got up out of bed this morning, you got your kids together, you've already had 3 or 4 arguments and fights between somebody, right? Like, if your kids are like my kids, we got issues. And you're here this morning, and God's about to do something, and I don't want you to miss it. Don't be the one that leaves and you missed it. Be the one that says, man, not only did I get it, I got more than I thought I was going to get. You know, I'm telling you, that's what you want today. Let me tell you kind of where we're going as we start this idea of new prayers that we're going to pray, dangerous prayers. There's nothing safe or benign about what we're going to talk about. If you start praying these prayers, things are going to start changing in your life in dramatic ways. It's going to be a dramatic change. It's not going to be like, hey, let's slowly, subtly. It's going to be like, boom, things are happening. Okay, but they're scary prayers. In fact, I would say most people, when you pray, most Christians in the United States, we pray safe prayers, don't we? Like, we pray prayers like, God bless us. That's a safe prayer. God help us. Good, but definitely safe. God bless us as we travel. Give us traveling mercies, right? That's doubly safe because you got the seatbelt and Jesus, so you're like doubly safe, right? Safe prayers. What I want to do is I want to arm you with some prayers that not only are they dangerous, but I'm telling you, if you'll pray them, God's going to expose some things in your life that need to be exposed. He's going to show you some things that you need to see that you couldn't see any other way. But because you let God have permission to go somewhere that's uncomfortable, God changes everything. He can change it for you. So let me talk about what we're going to do next week. Okay, set this up, plant this little seed in your heart. Next week, we're going to pray a prayer where we pray and we ask God to break us. Say, God, will you break me? Got one person excited about that, right? Everybody else is like, break me? What's that mean? I'm telling you, it's a do not miss message next Sunday. Because on the other side of God breaking us, on the other side of brokenness, God shows us stuff that we couldn't see any other way. We had to be broken in order to see it. And I'm telling you, that's a big one. Then the next week, I'm going to take you through a prayer where we pray and we say, God, send me wherever you want me to go. I'm signing a blank contract. Whatever, whenever, however, whyever, I don't even know. God, whatever you tell me to do, send me. I'm usable to be used by you. If you pray a prayer like that, let me just kind of let you know. At some point in my life, I prayed that prayer, and here I am as your pastor today. God might just use you to go into full-time ministry. God might change something where you go and you are a brighter light at your workplace than you've ever dreamed that you could be before. You say, send me. God might call you to do something you never thought you were equipped to do. And I'm telling you, he will be right there along the way. And you'll look up 5 years, 10 years from now and go, wow, I am so different. I'm telling you, God does that stuff. We're going to talk more about some other things. I'm not going to let the cat out of the bag on one thing, though. I'm holding close to the vest one thing, and you're just going to have to keep coming. That's why I say, don't miss church. You don't know what you're going to miss, right? But today, we're going to look at Psalm chapter 139, okay? Psalm 139, and we're going to talk about this guy named David who had his enemies were attacking him. Enemies were coming against him. I mean, they were vicious. They weren't just like, hey, call you names on the playground. They were like, hey, I'm here to kill you. Right? And so David is one of God's children. He's one of the leaders of the army of God's people. And so the enemies are not just attacking David, they're attacking God's people. And David's there and he's like, man, these people have horrible motives against me. They're trying to hurt me in bad ways. And instead of fighting back or becoming argumentative or getting really negative and critical, David, he's like, dude, I'm not even going to defend myself. Instead, I'm going to pray this prayer. And this is our first dangerous prayer we're going to talk about. He prays this prayer for God to search his heart. So instead of saying, this person's offended me, I'm mad at this person's coming after me, I don't know why they're this way, he says, search me, search my heart. It's a self-prayer. And he says, search me, God, know my heart. And then if you want to get real dangerous, you say, God, test me. Give me an opportunity to display whether my heart's good or bad. Nobody wants to do that. Right? This is dangerous. He says, know my anxious thoughts. In other words, know the things in my brain that are causing me anxiety, depression, fearfulness, suicidal thoughts. Know all that. Expose all that and see if there's anything offensive in me. Wow, you want to pray. Remember, for our traveling mercies. Bless this Mexican food to the nourishment of our body. It's like, safe prayers. Dangerous prayer is, hey, look at my heart and see if there's anything offensive in me and then lead me in the way of everlasting. Lead me. This is a dangerous prayer. Here's what I thought we'd do as we put it on the screen. I just want you to say it with me because I think that repetition works. And so you're going to hear me say this prayer over and over and over again throughout the message because I don't want you to come to church today. You took a chance coming here today. You weren't sure if this is going to be a good place or not. And you don't know if you're going to learn anything. You're going to walk away feeling like you grew or that God did something. You're not sure. I want you to walk out of here going, I know exactly what that message was about. Because I've been to places where I sit there, and it's not just churches, but I'm in a lot of different environments where I go, and I sit somewhere for an hour, and I go, I have no idea what that was. And my wife's looking at me, she's like, I don't know either, right? I don't want that to be you. We don't want that to be you. So on the count of three, I just want you, we're just going to read it together. Just say it with me, and let it get in your head, but then really I need it to fall straight here to your heart. So that's our goal. How do we get this into our head and straight to our heart? Ready? One, two, three. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me and lead me in the way everlasting. Thank you guys for participating. I love it. So it sounds so good. I want to break this prayer down into four parts because I think sometimes when we read the Bible, we can take two verses and just skim through them so fast that we're like, I don't even know what the significance of that verse is. Why is that even in the Bible, right? And so what I want to do is I want to break it down into four little chunks that we can digest easily and just let God speak to our heart through it. First thing he says, if you're taking notes, is he says, search my heart. He didn't say, search the enemy's heart, right? He search my heart. He says it very directly in verse 23, search me, God, and know what's in my heart. Know my heart. See, some of you guys are like, well, why would we pray and ask God to know what's in our heart? I don't understand that part. Doesn't God know anything, everything anyways? And so it's like not really that big of a deal. And besides, I got a pretty good heart. The problem with that is actually in Jeremiah 17:9, there's a scripture that talks about our hearts, and it says the human heart is the most deceitful of all things. So we would go, oh, well, she's got such a good heart, or he's got a good heart, or I've got a good heart. And yet God's word says that our hearts actually will lead us astray. So there's a difference between being led by the Spirit of God to go do something and then being led by what my heart feels. Let's remind ourselves, the heart, the human heart, is deceitfully wicked above all things. It's desperately wicked. And then it says, who really understands or knows how bad it is? In other words, it's so bad that we can't even diagnose how bad it is. And yet we're here and we're like, what does this have to do with anything, preacher? Well, our heart is not good without Jesus. We need Jesus residing inside this body that we have in order for us to even claim to have anything good. If Jesus would come, Jesus could do a cleaning job. He could do a purifying job. He could do something in our lives that would transform us from the inside out. He's looking for transformation to take place, but our hearts are desperately wicked. Above all things, who could even know how bad it is? It's so bad, right? Real quick, how many of y'all were in the house of the Lord? You're willing to be honest, and you're willing to say, you know what? I'm a liar. Would you put your hands to the air? Just raise your hand. You're a liar, right? Hey, I'm a liar. Put my hand. I'll double time that. I'm a double time liar, right? Keep your hand up for just a second. Okay, now look around. Look around at the people that don't have their hands up, and I want you to say, liar, liar, pants on fire. Okay? Dead serious right now. You know, all you people that said you were liars, I think you were the most truthful, all right? It's the other people, you know, they're the liars in the room. But I look at that, and, you know, we're all guilty of our own sins. But, you know, when it comes to lying, truthfully, I think more often than not, the biggest lie we tell is to ourselves. We tell it to ourselves. We lie to ourselves to believe certain things. Like, you know, I could say, well, you know, I'm not full of pride. No, really, I'm not full of pride. I can't help if I'm better than everybody else, right? I'm just, you know, it's subtle. But it's like, it's just the way it kind of default comes out. I don't lust. I don't lust at all. I just appreciate a really nice physique, right? Subtle. It's like, wait a second. Is that lustful or is that something else? I'm not materialistic. I just like to have really nice things all the time, right? And so we've got like this pathway we're supposed to go down. One's the spiritual path, and then one's this fleshly path, and they war between each other, back and forth. We say, I'm not a gossip. I never gossip. I just make sure that people know what prayer requests to pray for those people for, because they're really messed up, right? So I talk about their life to them, because we need prayer. It's a spiritual thing. And yet we're deceitful. We're liars. So David, he says, hey, before I do anything else with my enemies, I'm just going to pray, God, search me. Know what's in my heart. Show me what's in there. Because apparently I'm lying to myself and I can't see it. And I don't want to be deceived anymore. So, first time I heard this, or maybe I wouldn't say the first time, the last time I heard this, there was a guy that was at a men's conference, and he's going in, he's talking about this idea of having a really close relationship with God, where like God's like this number one in his life, and things are just so different whenever you have this deep relationship with him. And he's preaching, he's teaching this stuff. This guy was like a man on a mission. He was all business. He was like, I'm going to make sure that when people leave, they understand they can have this type of relationship with God. So I'm listening to him, and he's so passionate about what he's saying. He's just one of those guys that you're like, this dude believes this stuff. You meet those people where you're like, they're not just up there talking. Like, he believes it. And it was intriguing enough for me to go, if I could have a relationship with God like he's describing, I want that. And so he starts going through this scripture all about, you know, pray this prayer, search me, God, know my heart, test me, show me anything that's offensive in me. He's going through this whole thing, and I go, I want that so bad, what do I got to do? And he literally pauses in front of everybody, and he says, all right, I want everybody to go find a spot right now. You're going to get up, you're going to leave. He said, don't say one word to anybody. There's no conversation allowed. Don't say one word. He said, you've got that scripture, because he handed us a little thing. Got that scripture. He said, I want you to take it, go find a spot for 30 minutes, a half hour. I want you to pray just that prayer. Don't say anything else to God. No other words. You just pray this prayer for 30 minutes and you just sit there and listen. He said, it might be like you pray the prayer and you just sit there for 5 minutes, do nothing, just listen. Then you pray it again, 2 minutes, do nothing, whatever. He said, for 30 minutes, go do it. So I'm like, okay, if I could have more of God, then I'll do it. And so I went there, and I found my spot. And I went outside because I was like, dude, if I am near people, somebody's going to distract me. You know, I'll start talking to them about something that I don't need to talk about. I got to be away. So I'm outside. I'm literally sitting in the dirt. We're on like a mountain. And I'm sitting in the dirt, and I'm like, okay, God, whatever you want to do, do it. And I start praying this prayer. Search me, God. Know my heart. Test me. Show me anything in me that needs to go. And guys, I'm telling you, here's what God said. He said, you have an amazing heart. You're the best person I've ever created, and you're awesome. No, that's not what he said. All right, some of you are like, is he being serious? No. I wish I could say that. You know what God showed me that day? He said, Randy, you got pride, man. You're way too prideful. You're way too prideful. And he didn't audibly speak it. It wasn't one of those like, hey, an angel came down and spoke to Joseph moments, right? It was literally, but I heard it loud and clear. is like, dude, you're prideful and you need to stop. And I'm like, well, that's not encouraging at all. And I started thinking about it, and I'm just going to be transparent, because, I mean, if you can't be transparent in the house of God, something's really wrong, okay? This isn't a place for perfect people. It's a place for broken people. It's a place for people come and find healing, find freedom in Jesus, right? So I try to be as transparent as I can possibly be when I'm up here. I got to tell you, at this stage in our church probably had maybe 150, maybe 175 people in it, and I was so prideful that here's what I thought. I thought that the church would grow to 200, 250, 300 based on something that I would do. It would be a decision that I would make, a decision I wouldn't make. It would be something within my natural skill, ability, talent, whatever you want to call it. I thought in my head, God, you created me this way. You want me to go work as hard as I can. And if I do all this because of the gifting that you've given me and the mind you gave me, I'm going to be able to get where I need to go. And God was revealing to me in that day that that was all pride. And what he was doing is he was searching within my heart and showing me this so he could break me of it, so he could break it away. You say, what do you mean? Well, I was thinking, you know, anything awesome that's at Revolution Church, well, that's something that I brought to the table. That's something that I did. And that was my attitude. That was my mindset. And you know what God did? He took me through a season of saying, hey, I'll let you have all the credit, but you're going to have to do all the work. You've been trying to take all the credit anyways for everything that I do. So if you want to take all the credit, go ahead. I'll take my hand of favor away from you and I'll let you do all the work. And you know what you'll do? You'll burn the candle at both ends. You'll run 100 miles an hour and you won't get anywhere. You'll be like the hamster in the wheel doing this. But you've been so prideful. You've been trying to take praise and honor and glory for what I've done. You've claimed it for your own. You want to do it that way? Do it that way. And it was like loud and clear what I had been doing. And here's what I've learned through a process. See, when you pray a prayer and then God shows you something, hopefully it inspires you enough to change. And so I said, wow, at the end of the day, here's what I know, guys. I can tell you with full transparency, 100% honesty today, everything good about this church is because of God. And anything bad about this church is likely because of me. It's part of being the leader. But part of being the leader is that you got to know that your leader loves the Lord. I want to do what's right. And I pray prayers like this. Pray big prayers. I've prayed big prayers in my life a lot, where it's like impossible stuff is going to take place. It would only be, listen, I pray like that because I can't take any glory for when it happens. I love praying and saying, God, would you give us this building? This building you're sitting in right here, we had $2,000 in our building fund the day we found out about this building. We needed $825,000 in order to get into this building. Our church was less than half the size that it is now, okay? And we prayed a big prayer and we said, God, would you do it? And we had 90 days to get it done. 90 days. We did it in 72 days. Not because we had a bunch of wealthy people. Not because money kept. Listen, because God, when you pray a big prayer that's impossible in your power, it's impossible in your power, God has to show up or it won't work. Those are dangerous prayers. Those are awesome. Those are faith-filled prayers. I'm preaching another message coming up soon. Okay, that's coming. It's going to be so good. But God washed me away of some pride. He searched it out, and he worked it out. And today, I ask you to let God search it out and work it out of you. Because there's some areas of your life that need to be adjusted. There are certain things that God leads us to do at this church that, quite honestly, people don't understand. So as the pastor, sometimes God gives us a vision or a direction or a strategy, and we go, God, we just want to be used by you. Whatever you show us, we'll do. And sometimes he calls us to do stuff that doesn't make sense to the general congregant. They don't understand. They're like, why are we doing that? It doesn't make sense. Pastor, are you sure that we should do that? And for instance, I'll give you a great example. It happened about 6-7 weeks ago. I ran growth track on a Sunday morning during the worship hour, during this hour. Like, instead of inviting you to come to the class, I said, we're going to do it during church. And I had several people come up to me and go, preacher, what are you doing? Like, why would you do that? I had some people come up to me and they say, but what about all the people that just went through growth track? Like, all these people just went through growth track, a bunch of them. So why are you doing it? I said, I can't tell you anything more than I feel like God wants me to run growth track on Sunday morning during church hour in all the services. And they were like, looking at me like, I was like, I had three heads or something, right? It was super strange, super weird. We get to the first week, and I preach the growth track, and people are like, okay, yeah, it's growth track, yeah. Second week, I do it, and people are like, okay, so how's this going to work on the fourth week whenever we're like doing it? And I told them, I said, guys, to be honest with you, I have no clue. And they're like, well, don't you have a plan? I'm like, no, I really don't. God just wants us to do this on Sunday morning during church hour, and that's all I know. And I don't know how it's going to end. I don't know how it's going to work. I don't know anything. I know nothing. Isn't that great to have a leader that knows nothing? Oh, man, so good. Some of y'all feel that way about your boss right now. You're like, my boss don't know nothing, right? So your preacher, I'll just tell you, he don't know a whole lot either. I just try to lean on God and let him use me however he wants. But so I'm doing it. We get to week four. I have no clue what to expect, and 123 people discovered their purpose and joined a dream team. 123. And I look back and I go, all right, God, I see what you were up to. And here's what I want to say. I want to thank you as a church, because even though you said, dude, what are we doing? Really, you still trusted me with it. And thank you for trusting your pastor enough to just do what doesn't make sense. Sometimes we get called to do things that doesn't make sense. God will lead us in a direction, and he gives us some information. We go, we got to go walk that out. And I know it's not going to always make sense to everybody that's looking at it. But as long as we're in tune with the Lord, we're praying prayers like, and by the way, this isn't just a prayer that we pray. Our whole staff prays this. God, search us. If there's something we need to change, show us. When we pray a dangerous prayer like that, let me tell you what happens. You get super close to the Lord. And some of you guys, you've been saying, I want to grow. I want to grow. Well, dude, why don't you start growing? You start throwing it all on God like it's his fault that you aren't growing. You're not growing because you're not putting yourself in a position to grow. There's so much that you can gain if you just tap into the resource. David prayed, search my heart. And then second part of this prayer, he says, reveal my fears. He says, know my anxious thoughts. Know my anxious thoughts. I want to ask you this question, because I think we need to go here. What is it that makes you fearful or afraid? Like, what is it that internally makes you afraid? Inside of you, it starts welling up. I'm not talking about like a snake or a spider. Of course, yeah, that's that. I'm not talking about when you go down to use the toilet and you have to move the shower curtain to make sure there's nobody back there. I don't know if y'all do that, but every time I go in, if that shower curtain's closed, I'm looking behind it, make sure ain't nobody back there. And I'm ready in case there is, right? Like, I'm not talking about those kind of fear. I'm talking about like internally fearing like that you're gonna lose your job. Stuff that makes you anxious. Stuff of like, I'm afraid that I'm not going to be married by such and such age. Maybe your fear is you're afraid of being stuck in a marriage that you feel like isn't going anywhere. You're not going to ever get past this spot that you're in. You're stuck. Maybe you're afraid of the future, or maybe you're afraid of the unknown. Maybe you're afraid of failing or afraid of loss. What if I lose somebody, or if I lose something that's valuable to me? I've got to hold on to this thing. We have all these things in us, and it may look different for different people, but at the end of the day, there's certain things that makes us anxious. Why does this matter that we would say, God, show me my anxious thoughts? Why is that such a big deal? Well, maybe you would write this down. What we fear the most reveals where we trust God the least. What we fear the most actually reveals where we're trusting God the least. Think about it. If I'm scared to death that my marriage isn't going to work, then I'm really taking the God factor out of my marriage. I'm taking God out of my marriage. I'm thinking that it won't work. But if you have God, you have everything that you need. If you're going to take anything out of the marriage, there's probably some stuff that does need to go, but I don't think God's the answer. I think God's the glue that's keeping it together. So don't forsake that. Maybe you're afraid you're not going to be able to pay your bills. That would be you really not trusting God with your finances. Don't remove the God equation. If I'm afraid I've got to be a helicopter parent because everywhere I go, I got to keep my children safe because nowhere is safe, right? And I understand, we live in 2019, you got to keep a close eye on your kids. It's not like when we grew up, just play outside for 9 hours and, you know, your parents don't even know where you're at, all right? You've been at the pond 5 miles away, right? I get it, it's different. But at the end of the day, you know, some helicopters don't fit in certain environments. And so you're a helicopter parent and you're going everywhere because you're really not trusting God with your kids. Whatever you're fearing the most reveals where you're trusting God the least. So I begin to pray this prayer. Let me just tell you the story of what happened. It's pretty crazy. So I realized that I can be could be a very proud person. I could be prideful. Then God began to show me in this area of the anxious thoughts. He showed me that, man, I've got this, I'm just scared to death of failing. Of failing. And in fact, I would say that I'm so scared to death of failing that most of the successes that I've had in my life happened because I was so terrified of failing. Okay, so I drove and drove and drove and drove and drove because I was scared of that. I was anxious about it. And as I prayed more on that, I recognized that it's not just a fear of failing, but it's actually a fear of letting people down. I have a fear of letting people down. I don't want to let anybody down. And so then I would drive because I can't let anybody down. And then I just got into this deeper level of praying, and I realized that I have a massive fear of being inadequate or not being enough, not being good enough, not being righteous enough, not being smart enough as a preacher, not being this or that. You know, I'm trying to accomplish all this, not being whatever enough. And all those things, and you know what that does? It leads to anxiety and stress and pressure, fearfulness, suicidal thoughts. And here's what I found in the scripture. The Bible tells us that your pastor cannot be led by fear. He has to be led by faith. Because the Bible teaches us that without faith, it's actually impossible to please God without faith. So I can't be so fearful of what people are going to say or what people are going to do. And listen, this is my natural tendency. I was just born this way where I'm naturally a people pleaser. Who's a people pleaser in the room? Would you put your hands here? People pleaser. Thank you for pleasing me right now and putting your hand into the air, okay? Naturally a people pleaser. I'm telling you, that's my natural way. And sometimes through faith in God, God gives a direction and he goes, you can't be fearful of what the people are going to think, what they're going to respond with, what they're going to do. You can't be fearful of any of that. You have to go lead in this way. And I learned this recently. It was so good. Basically, the thought was this. You don't lead around a problem. You lead through a problem. Now, my natural tendency is, how can I dance around this? Because I'm a people pleaser. How do I keep the least amount of damage? And then I go, wait a second. I need to go where I'm uncomfortable. And I need to go do what I don't want to go do. And when I do that, there's a freedom there of knowing that, hey, you're in the presence of the Lord. You're doing what I've asked you to do. God began to reveal to me in some of these anxious moments some scripture. 1 John chapter 4, verse 8 says, perfect love, God's love, his perfect love, casts out all fear. Because it's the love of Christ. His perfect love casts out all fear. That's 1 John 4, 18. Okay, if you look at another scripture, 2 Timothy 1, 7 says this, God has not given me a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. And I know now that when I'm feeling that anxiousness, that depression, those suicidal thoughts, all those things, they're not of God because God did not put those there. He didn't give me a spirit of fearfulness, but of power. I should be strong, not weak. And you know what I feel whenever I got all that going? I feel real weak. But I'm not supposed to feel that way. I'm supposed to feel powerful, strong, love. Love should be exuded, not discouragement and depression. And a sound mind. It should be clear, peaceful. So I just dare you. I double dog dare you. In fact, Christmas is coming up, so I'm going to pull the Christmas story. I, Ralphie, triple dog dare you. Triple dog dare you to pray a dangerous prayer like this. Because when you do, God's going to reveal something about yourself that maybe you have not been willing to acknowledge for many, many years. He's going to show you something. Because the lie we often tell, the biggest one, is to ourselves. Number three part of this, David prays, and this is so much more difficult. He says, uncover my sins. That's literally what he's saying. He says, I want you to search me out, God. See if there's any offensive way in me. If there's anything that needs to be worked out or that's inconsistent with what you want, I want you to expose it. Show it to me. Uncover it. Dangerous prayer. I don't know if you've noticed this or not, but it's a lot easier to look at somebody else and see their issues than it is to look in the mirror and see our own. We don't like that. In fact, we're really good at excusing ourselves and accusing somebody else. We always want to excuse ourselves, but we're so quick to accuse somebody else. We can be very judgmental. Think about it. Can you believe she walks in here like that, thinking she's hot stuff and all this? I can't believe she's doing that. And we get real critical of this person over here. Or so-and-so, they walk in here saying this or that. And, you know, they shouldn't even talk. I don't know why they think they can talk like that. What do they have to show for it? You know, we're so judgmental, so quick to jump on those bandwagons, and we shouldn't. We shouldn't. It's so easy to see everybody else's sins, but not our own. I'll give you an example that actually happened this past week. I love to date our children. I got four kids, and I love my kids to death. They're the coolest people in all the world. Like, they're so much cooler than you. I'm not even gonna lie to you. I love my kids, right? I expect you to love your family more than you love me too, okay? So hey, we're even playing field here. But at the end of the day, I'm dating my kids, and I took my son Jace out, because we go out, and basically we'll go to like a Sonic or Baskin Robbins. We're gonna go to some ice cream place, we're gonna sit, and we just get an ice cream, and we just talk. I talk about their life, I talk about their day, I talk about what's going on with them. And then there's always one teaching moment that I go over with them, and they get pumped up, man. They are so excited to listen to their father still, because they're still young, right? And so they get excited to spend time with me. They're always asking, when are we going on a father Sunday? When are we going on a daddy daughter day? Ooh, when I hear that one, I'm like, let's go right now. Like, I love my daughter, right? Like, love it. Love it. She's so cute. And so we go out there and I want to teach them something. So I'm going over with Jace. He's 7 years old. Going over the word integrity. What does the word integrity mean? So you ask him and they have no clue. And he guesses like for 5 minutes and he's like nowhere near what it is, right? It's God, you know, like God's always the right answer. So like Jesus comes out, I'm like, no, it's not that. Let me explain. And so I teach him that integrity means doing the right thing even if no one else is around or looking. Will you do the right thing when no one's looking? So I'm having this conversation, and he gives a couple examples of one time when he did it, and I don't know if he did it or not because he was by himself, right? But, you know, Jace. And so I'm like, yeah, good job, dude, you did it. And so it wasn't shortly after that. In fact, it was probably 3 or 4 days later. We're driving down the road, and I'm late to an appointment. Okay, I'm late, and I'm driving, and guys, I'm flying, okay? I'm flying. We're here today to tell truth, and I'm just telling you, I was flying, okay? And I'm getting where I need to go, and I know it's not good, and I know we're supposed to obey the law, so, I will confess that for sure. But I'm going through, and I see the lights coming up, and the light goes from green to yellow. And I'm thinking to myself, baby, I'm flying. I can get through that thing, all right? I'm like, we'll make it. Okay, and then I got close enough because I was going, I made the decision, I'm going, and I got close enough where it's yellow, and I don't know if you guys ever have this moment in time, this little second where you think to yourself, if I look up right now, it'll turn red, yeah. Right? And so it's yellow, and I'm thinking, as long as I don't look at it turn red, it doesn't count. Right? It doesn't count that I went through a red light if I didn't see that it was red. Y'all, I don't know if that happens to you. Happens to me a lot. I don't know if I got a speeding problem or what, but I'm like, hey, if I don't look, and my son, my seven-year-old's in the back seat, and he goes, hey, daddy, and I turn the music down because I'm blaring, and he goes, you just ran that red light, and he goes, you remember what integrity is? Just because there's no cops around doesn't mean... I was so proud and so angry in that moment at the same. I was like, yes, no, right? He totally called me. My seven-year-old son called me out. So much easier to see a problem in somebody else and not see it in ourselves. So we need some help. Because sometimes some people see stuff that we don't see. So I want to give you three very quick things that help us when we're praying this prayer. God, uncover my sin. Show me anything in me. Well, he might use three different areas to show you some stuff. It's not going to be this audible voice maybe. But here's three ways to get self-aware, okay? Number one, we're gonna ask ourselves this question. What are people trying to tell me? What are people trying to tell me? Let me explain what this means, okay? If you have people that love you, I'm not talking about your enemies. Everybody's got a hater. They're gonna hate, right? Haters gonna hate, okay? I'm talking about the people that love you. The lover's gonna love, okay? I'm talking about those people. Those loving people that come into your life that say, hey, you know, I don't know if you see this or not, but when I'm around you, it seems like you tend to go negative. It seems like that's your thing. If you have several people that you love and respect, they're coming to you and saying, hey, you tend to go that route, or you're critical, or, you know, it seems like a lot of times you're always talking about somebody else. I don't know if you realize that's gossip or not, but that's gossip. If you have other people coming around you trying to tell you that, listen, I'm just being straight and honest with you as best I can, okay? You probably ought to listen to those good people in your life. Because the common denominator in this scenario is you, okay? If you have good people come and try and tell you that, you gotta listen. The second question to give you some self-awareness is, what is it that I have been rationalizing? What have I rationalized? You know, in other words, yeah, this may not be right, but it's not really that big of a deal, is it? This is just my way of coping. You know, this is my one thing that I do, right? And I'm not hurting anybody else. So we try to rationalize it away and kind of, you know, narrow it down. It's not that big of a deal, really. If I was hurting somebody else, yes. But no, it's just me. This is just my one thing. What are you rationalizing? That's probably, honestly, if you're rationalizing it, it's probably sin. It's probably sin. See, again, we're praying this dangerous prayer. God, reveal in me anything that's not supposed to be there. And if you're rationalizing it, it's probably not good. Third thing is this. Where am I the most, oh, this is so good. Where am I the most defensive? Nope, we're not going to talk about that. We've already talked about it. I don't want to talk about it anymore. No. We had this discussion, and we have these conversations with our spouse or whomever, and you know, they keep wanting to bring it up, and you don't want to talk about it. Why do you not want to talk about it? See, you probably don't want to talk about it because there's some sin there. And what happens is God starts doing a work in your heart, and he starts uncovering some of this stuff, and he shows you what's in you. This guys, some of you guys are going to leave here and go, I ain't praying that prayer. Because you don't want to change. You're not going to pray that prayer because you're scared of what might happen. Let me just tell you, it might feel hard in the moment, but life is so much better than you just living in sin. I promise you that. 100% certain of it. 100% certain. Because there's no joy in sin. Sin is good for a moment. For a moment. I'm not going to stand here and tell you sin's not fun. Sin's fun, dude. Sin is so fun. You know, preacher, what's he talking? Sin is fun. Otherwise, nobody would do it. Am I right? I mean, I'm like, yeah, we do it because it seems fun. But it's temporary satisfaction. And there's nothing like being in tune with your God and being pure and holy in your heart, having him search you out. There's something to that that's so much greater than living this lifestyle that's no good. So we ask ourselves these three questions. In fact, I'm going to share a quick story, being super transparent this morning. In the early years of the church, I would do some funny stuff, man. Stuff that wasn't necessarily good, but it was what we did. Let me say it this way. Okay, back when we had about 200 people, I would get appointments scheduled for me. And we would meet up, and I was thinking we're just like going to do a get to know with these people, or, you know, establish a deeper relationship with some people that have been coming for a long time, maybe. And when I would get to these meetings, I'm telling you, like, maybe 12, 15 different times this happened to me, where people would say, I really like the church. I really do. I really like you. I like you. I like what's going on. There's just one thing that you do that just is not good. And I'm like, and they didn't necessarily say like, that's how I heard it, right? They said it in love. They were trying to do the right thing. And they're saying, you know, some of the wording that you use and language you use is a little crude. It's a little crude. Like you have like potty humor, or, you know, you got issues that's the one thing here that I'm just not sure about. And you know what I would do? Immediately I'd get defensive. Right, because that's what we do. We got to buck up and we got to get defensive. And I'm like, well, these people are just old prunes and, you know, prudes or whatever. And they just, you know, they don't understand. You know, who the Son set free is free indeed, is what the Bible said. And the God set me free, and I'm not living in legalism and bondage of all that anymore. And I'm just, you know, I'd leave there and I'd pray for them. I'm like, God, will you set them free so they can just have a good time instead of having a bad time all the time? You know, that was my attitude towards those people. And it wasn't until this guy came up to me that I just really respected and I loved. And he came up and he said, hey, Randy, he said, I want you to, and he's so wise, wise beyond his years. He said, I want you to know that I love you. He said, I really do. And he said, I'm in no matter what. You know, thick, thin, good, bad, ugly, hailstorm, fire falling on you, I'm in. I love God. I love this church. I'm in. I love it. I love you. And he said, but you know, there's a lot of people that have walked around and said that you're kind of crude in some of the language that you use. And he said, you know, I don't know if you are or you're not. And I think he knew. But hey, he said, I don't know if you are or you're not. He said, but would you just pray about that? And he said, you know, if you are, God will show you. And if you're not, then God won't. And I respected this person. So I said, yeah, I can pray that. And it wasn't like this big, you know, massive moment. It was just, yeah, okay, yeah, dude, you're telling me that I love you. I'll pray about it. No big deal. So I would prepare my messages, and I had this one message coming up. It was like 3 weeks in advance. I had a zinger, dude. I had this one line that I was going to say that it was like, dude, when I say this line, zing, you know, this is going to be so good. Let me just say it this way. The sinful side of you would have loved it, okay? You would have loved it, okay? But the spiritual side of you would have said, I don't know if we should have said that, right? And so you say, well, was it on the line? It could have been the line. It could have been 5 steps over the line. I'm not really sure, but here's what I can tell you. I begin to pray and say, God, tell me if I've got this issue or not. If I need to change something, I'll change, but you got to be clear. You got to show me. So here we are. We get to the message, and I'm super pumped up because that zinger line's coming up. And I'm like, dude, I've been waiting for this 3 weeks, and we're finally here. We're building to the climax, and it just so happened that my son JJ wasn't feeling well that day. And so at this stage, this is probably what? This is 3.5, 4 years ago. He happened to come into the church, and he's sitting right here on the left side, okay? And he's sitting there, and all of a sudden, my eye catches him, you know, because the lights are so, I can always see. So I catch him, and I'm like, dude, JJ's in the service today. And I'm up here preaching, and I'm getting ready to get to that point, and it was like God spoke to me loud and clear in the middle of me speaking. I don't even know what the message was that day. Like, it wasn't even, I don't know what they heard. All I know is the message was for me. And God was saying, listen, are you okay with your son hearing what you're about to say? It's in that moment that God just changed me. And I was like, oh gosh, man, all these people have been right this whole time. The biggest lie we tell is to ourselves. I said, man, I'm not okay with my son. I don't want him to hear this. So therefore, this is not good for my church to hear. When you pray a prayer as dangerous as what we're talking about today, God's going to point out some things that you've been trying to explain away, brush under the rug. It's not that big of a deal. Rationalize. But let me just tell you, denying the truth doesn't make it any less true. Just because I didn't look up to look and see, oh, it is red, didn't mean that it wasn't red when I sailed through it. God's going to show you some stuff. Now, I want to say this. When you have the courage to pray a prayer like this and God brings something to the light, there's two things that need to happen. Two things, two different types of confession. Number one, it's found in 1 John 1:9. It says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The first thing we do is we confess to God for forgiveness. We start there. We got to go to God for forgiveness. But then we go to his people for healing. Don't miss that. That was huge. You almost missed it. We confess our sin to God for forgiveness, but we go to his people to find healing. And there's a lot of people, you've privately prayed to God, and you've confessed to God. He forgave you of that, by the way. But you got to go to his people for healing, because James 5:16 says it this way. Confess your sins to one another and pray for each other, so that way you might be healed. Confess your sins to each other for your benefit. It's not for God's benefit. God doesn't get any benefit based on whether you do or you don't. So you may be healed. And there's a lot of us, we haven't found freedom because you haven't gotten in a group to build a relationship with anybody to where you can feel comfortable enough to actually do that. And I'm telling you, it matters. Now, I just want to tell you, this is a place where imperfect people are being transformed by a perfect God. We're all imperfect. We all don't have it together. In fact, if you think you're perfect, this isn't the church for you. How do I know that? Well, you should go polish your halo somewhere else and just wear it on Sundays and make it look like you're all got it all together. If we're being real with each other, I don't have it all together, and neither do you, right? So this has got to be a place where we can come and experience the freedom that only God can provide. What am I telling you? Let me summarize what I just said, okay? I prayed this prayer, and God said, you're prideful. You don't want to fail. You don't want to let people down. I always want to live up to people's expectations. I can be guilty of telling, you know, bad jokes that are inappropriate. I've got issues. I've got all sorts of issues, and it's led me to a place where I need to depend on God to do something. And by the way, that's where you want to be too. You want to be in a place where God can do something. And this is disturbing how bad your pastor is. It's also very real, right? Here's where I'm getting at. The last thing that David does is he says, lead me, God, to the way of everlasting. After he confesses and after he says, search my heart, tell me what's inside, show me what I need to do, he says, then lead me in the way of everlasting. Lead me. Lead me. So when you came in, she got a rock that looks just like this. I'm going to invite the worship team to make their way up at this time. This rock, I want you to grab your rock. I want you to hold it up high into the air real quick. Let me see that you got it. See you got it. Okay, here's your rock. want you to hold it right in front of you now and just look at it for a second. If you didn't get a rock and you want a rock, we're all going to use this in here in just a second. Put your hands to the air. Let us know you need one. We'll get some volunteers to put a rock in your hand if you need one. We've got some people right over here. They need a rock. Okay, right here, right here. Right. Keep your hands up for a second because we've got several people. She's going to come around, okay? She's going to come around. I want you to think of one area of your life that you know that's not pleasing to the Lord. There might be more than one, right? But this rock is going to be symbolic of sin this morning. One area that you struggle with. In fact, I want to put the whole prayer back on the screen if we can. Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there's any offensive way in me and lead me in the way of everlasting. I want you to pray this prayer right now. Don't even pray anything else. God, here's my prayer. And I want you to think about the one area that you need to confess. And then what I want you to do is I want you to make your way forward. I want you to drop your sin into that bucket. Got another bucket right over there. And as soon as you hear that rock hit that bucket, here's what this means. It's a confession saying, God, I'm done with that. I'm throwing it away. Now listen, if you want to hold on to your sin, then by all means, take your rock with you. But at the end of the day, this is a time of confession where we say, God, not what I want, but what you want. What you want. And then the moment you hit that bucket and you hear that noise, that is God saying you are forgiven. And you leave it there. You don't pick it back up. You leave it there. And then here's what this does. I want you to, as you're walking away, I want you to pray this prayer. Lead me in the way of everlasting. You lead me. Show me what's next. Help me. Then I want you to go back to your seat, and I want to let this worship speak to your heart. We're going to sing a song called I Surrender. I Surrender. There's no longer going to be this battle between you and God of what should happen. Just go, God, I'm all in. I surrender. These are obstacles that have been in my way, but they're no longer going to be here. Just stand to your feet at this time. Maybe God's spoken to your heart about what that area is already. If so, go ahead and get out of your seat and make your way forward. Maybe it'll take a minute. Make your way forward when you feel comfortable, and let's lead in worship. And you guys, sing with us. Worship our God. Bye. Church, I'm proud of you. So proud of you right now. So proud of you. Many of you, you listened to the voice of God and you repented of something today. Many of you. And there's a freedom that comes with knowing that we're right with God. There's this peace that comes in knowing that we're right with our Creator. Now my prayer over you is that He would lead you to the way everlasting. He would lead you. This is means that you need to be in daily talk with Him. It can't be a Sunday to Sunday thing. I know a lot of you guys are brand new to the church world, so you don't understand like the whole, like this got to be a daily thing. Or you say, God, what is it you want from me today? God, I'm going to listen to you. Some of you guys have never prayed before. And I want you to know, it's just like eating a Reese's. There's no wrong way to eat a Reese's, and there's really no wrong way to say a prayer. You just got to talk to God and say, God, this is what's going on in my heart. This is what's going on in my life. God, I need direction. Lead me. And I promise you that God will answer you. 100% sure. He's not going to stay silent on you. In fact, He's been trying to speak to you. We're really just trying to turn the volume up a little bit in your life. That's all we're really doing here. Just turn it up to where you can hear clearly. There's some of you today that you came into church and maybe you've never been to a church before. There's a couple things I want you to know. Number one is, dude, we are so glad that you're here with us. Like, number one, first and foremost, this is a great spot for you, for your family. We're glad that you're doing life with us, and we hope to get to know you better in such greater ways than we do today. Number two is, you need to know this. If I never see you again, you need to know there's a God that loves you. God loves you. And He wants a relationship with you so much that He was willing to surrender His life on a cross. We've all seen the cross necklaces. Maybe you didn't really know the significance of what it was. He went to that cross and He was nailed to that cross. The Bible says because sin had to be paid for. Sin had to be paid for. And when He went to that cross, the Bible says that He shed His blood for the payment of sin. And anyone, this is anybody, you, me, the worst person in the world, anyone that would call on His name to be saved, the Bible says they can have salvation through Jesus Christ. That His death on the cross can cover their sin. But here's the thing. God doesn't hold a gun to our heads and say, you have to love me. No. He invites you to have a relationship with Him. And for some of you today, you're hearing this maybe for the very first time. Maybe this is the 100th time and now you're ready to surrender. Whatever the case may be, there's some of you that you need to pray and you need to invite God to be number one in your life. You need to start a relationship with Him and say, the death on the cross, that was for me, and I believe that. The story doesn't end, though, right there. I always laugh at people wearing the cross necklaces because I'm like, you know, the cross was just a part of the story. That's like the middle part of the movie. The end of the story is that Jesus came back to life to prove to you, to prove to me that He's a God worth following, and that if we give our lives to Him, He'll change everything for the better, not for the worse. And so I come to you today and I say, some of you, you need to start that relationship with God where you surrender it all to Him and you have your sin forgiven. In fact, we have a prayer we're going to put on the screen. This is called a commitment prayer. And this is where you just give your life to Jesus and you accept what He did for you. And maybe God would be leading you to pray this with me. If so, just repeat this prayer after me. Say, dear God, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending Jesus for me. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Forgive me of my sin. Forgive me for doing life my way. Show me your way. Fill me with your Spirit and guide me by your word. Make me who you created me to be. Amen. Church, welcome new families into the family of God. Amen. Amen. Two things and we'll be out of here. Two things very quickly. When you came in and you worship God, there's this gray card. And we'd love for you to fill this out. And on the bottom it says, I made a commitment to follow Jesus today. If you pray and you ask God to be part of your life, to be number one, man, we want to celebrate as a church with you what God's doing in your life. I have some information I'd love to send you in the mail this week that just talks about your next steps and how we can come alongside you and help you in different ways. And so if you check this box, drop this at the New Here Start Here station outside there to a volunteer, or you can just drop it in any of these black boxes located on the back wall. And some of you guys are like, that would be great if I had one of these cards, but I didn't get one of these cards. Now what do I do? Just pull out your phone and text the word new me to the number on the screen. New me, but don't put a space in the word new me. One word. New me, one word. Okay? 31996. I will electronically send you that same information. I see some of you guys doing that right now. Man, guys, we are so excited for what God is doing in your life. Thank you for being a part. And guys, for those of you that are already followers of Jesus Christ, thank you for paving the way for these people right here. Thank you for contributing, serving, giving of your time, your talents, and your treasure. Because of you, today somebody's in heaven that wouldn't have been there any other way. So I thank you for that. Next week's a don't miss message. I will see you guys then. Have a great week.